Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for this joyous time with you. Thank you, Father, that yes, you are our daily bread. And Father, we thank you for Howard and the bread that you've given him this morning, Father, your word to give to us. Holy Spirit, I pray that each and every one of us are ready for this word, that we will hear, but not just hear, we will hear and do. Father, it will be treasure to our hearts, Father, and that we will, with your help by your Holy Spirit, Father, learn more and act more like you, Father, becoming more of who you created us to become. So Holy Spirit, just come, fill Howard, top him up and overflow him, Lord, as he breathes out your word like you did with your breath, Lord, and brought life to everything. Let it bring life to us today, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Debbie. Good morning, church. Just check you can hear me. I'm just trying to position myself where I can see you all. Okay, good morning, church. Let's get straight down to it. I had a word I was preparing. Oh, it was good. I was so proud of it. Oh, I had a great story to start with. Something really intellectual and clever, you know, and you'd say, wow, wow, wow. And then the Lord just said to me, no. I want you to talk about me. More about me. So I said, okay, what do you want me to talk about? What am I going to preach on? And he said, well, Psalm 23 is one that most people will know. So I want you to talk about Psalm 23. So I said, that's fine, Lord. I have some experience with sheep. I have known sheep in my life. I have looked after sheep. They're not the best, not the most intelligent of creatures, are they? So when David wrote Psalm 23, that begins, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," he who was a shepherd was putting himself in the position of a sheep. The sheep aren't that clever, but they can be very clever. Let me just tell you, when I was 11, 12 years old, something like that, my father, who was very imaginative and perhaps an alternative thinker, saw things different ways, and he decided that we would move from our very comfortable house in the middle of the town. My school was just around the corner and everything, and we were going to move out into the country. So we got this house in the country, and this house had land. And then he had the great idea that he was going to get some sheep, because the sheep would keep the grass low and he wouldn't have to cut the grass so much. So in the area we lived, there were a lot of sheep. And at certain times of the year, you saw these white sheep all over the countryside. I could see them from my bedroom window. The only thing is, he decided he'd buy black sheep. He'd buy Welsh mountain sheep, which are black. And he found someone in Wales who had six of these, and he bought them. And so these six ewes, female sheep, arrived and were put into our field. And it seemed to be going really well. And we were looking after them. But then he decided he wanted to breed. He wanted more sheep. So he couldn't find a ram, a male black mountain sheep. But what he did find was what's called a Jacob ram. And these originate from Israel. And Jacob rams can have four horns. Magnificent animals. And he found a Jacob ram and he bought it. And it went in the field with the sheep, who had been behaving beautifully. Everything seemed to be going well. Except we lived quite close to a Royal Air Force station, Wittering it's called. And I used to see from my bedroom window, I could see the jets taking off and landing. And one night, he got a call from the commander of the Air Force base. And the commander said, can you come and collect your Jacob Ram? And I said, what do you mean? Can you come and collect the black ram that's yours? And he said, why? He's in our field. And the commander said, no, he's not. He's on our runway. And I've got planes waiting to land. Now, we didn't realize that this Jacob Ram could escape. Very, very agile. And he was escaping at night. So anyway, my father tried to take measures to make sure he couldn't escape anymore. And we thought everything was all right. Until next spring came. And the farmers started to have black lambs in their white herds. And this Jacob Ram, I think he'd been out most nights. I'm not going to say any more than that. But he certainly left his mark on North Cambridgeshire. So that was our experience, and we, in the end, we had to get rid of the sheep for obvious reasons. But I learned a thing or two in that time. So when I speak this morning about Psalm 23 and shepherds and lambs, I'm speaking from a position of a little bit of knowledge, a little bit of authority. Thing is, can we put up verse 1 there? Thanks very much, Dominic. I think we probably all heard this psalm, know this psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. It starts with that declaration that God leads me. He's my shepherd, I go where God says. Yeah? And let's just start with that. Who is your shepherd? We all serve something or somebody. Regular ARC members would immediately say, I serve God. But sometimes we say we're serving God, but we're serving something else. We're secretly serving maybe an addiction. Something that we shouldn't be doing. That we do in private because we're ashamed of it. Maybe we serve betting. Maybe we secretly like to bet online. Maybe we serve money. Money is everything to us. We want money. Our lives are built up around money. Maybe your life is built around you, what you want. And some people build their lives around their bodies, don't they? Their body, their body, their body. We serve somebody or something. I hear a lot of people these days saying, why do you want to serve a God? Why do you want to put yourself under authority? It's about freedom. And me doing what I want to do. That's what people want. But when those people encounter hard, hard times, where do they go? The only place they've got to go to is themselves. Or friends around them. But when you have a shepherd, he shows you where to go. He shows you the way out of trouble. He protects you. I shall not want. I shan't want. We immediately think, well, we'll be well fed. We'll have money in the bank. We'll have a house. Yes, God is our shepherd and looks after us. But more than that, he ensures you don't crave other things. You don't crave other things. You don't want to create other gods in your life because he is enough. He is all you need. Can we put up verse 2? I'm moving fairly quickly because I'm aware of time. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Okay, sheep lie down. They love lying down. But they only lie down when there's four conditions. When there's four conditions. The first one is, when they're not hungry. If they're hungry, they're looking for food. They're looking to graze. So they only lie down if they're not hungry. When you make the Lord your shepherd, you're not hungry. If you fulfill your part, you won't go hungry. They'll lie down when there's no fear. Fear is not from God. Fear is from someone else. And we mustn't give in to fear. Fear is so easy to give in to. Have you seen my bank account? I'm afraid I won't get to the end of the month. Give it to God. Give it to the shepherd. I'm ill. This could be terrible. This could be terminal. Give it to God. I'm not a very good driver. I don't want to drive. Think twice. God is there. Your shepherd is there. Sheep will lie down when there's no tension with people around them or sheep around them. Sheep, you know, they have their conflicts. They have their pecking order. They have their personalities. But when they're at peace with the herd, they will lie down. And lastly, they'll lie down when they've got no flies or parasites or anything. I remember seeing a sheep that was being shorn and maggots and things coming out of the wool. But if the sheep are clean and looked after, they're at peace. And when you come to Christ, he makes sure that evil doesn't put things in your life that will irritate you, that will gnaw away at you. And if the enemy does get in because you do something wrong, he'll get rid of it. He can get rid of it. Because he wants you to be able to lie down in green pastures. We can't be at peace if we always do things our way. If we always do things our way. The richest people in the world, do you think they're at peace? Famous people, people with money, celebrities, influences who don't know Christ. I believe I have a lot more peace in my life than they do in theirs. Imagine having to organise 3 or 4 houses around the world and all your staff and everything. Must be terrible. He leads me beside still waters. The shepherd makes sure that the sheep have water. There's 3 sources of water for sheep. And David would have known this. And remember that in those times, when this was written, the countryside wasn't as developed as we think of it. Don't think of the picture of Jesus with a lamb over his shoulder. Being a shepherd was hard work. Hard work out in the elements every day. And the shepherds had to make sure that the sheep had water. David, when he was a shepherd, he made sure that his flock had water. And a main source of water was the dew on the ground in the morning. The sheep take the dew in the morning when they're not near other sources of water. And you know, we should take the dew every morning. We should get up and say, Lord, thank you for this new day. Drink of him first thing in the morning, and it sets you up for the day. The other source of water, or one of the other sources of water, is wells. But again, there weren't that many wells set up and established. Shepherds would often know the terrain, and they would dig wells for their sheep. And they would sometimes go down into wells and bring water up for the sheep. And you know, Jesus will dig deep when you're thirsty and you need water. He will dig deep for you. And of course, there are streams and rivers. Shepherds know where they are, and they take their sheep there. The thing is with sheep is that they're lazy and they want quick solutions to their problems. So the shepherd might be leading a flock to a river, but the sheep will drink polluted water out of puddles, which are contaminated, which give them parasites, which give them diseases. And some of those diseases, they don't notice or they don't come to fruition until later on. And isn't that like us when we take our own decisions? We drink polluted water, we think we've got away with it, and then later on we realize we've made a terrible, terrible mistake. Maybe a bit like my father buying a Jacob Ram. He thought he was being so clever. He even boasted about it a bit to his friends. But look at the trouble it got him in. If you do things in your own strength and don't do what the shepherd has prepared for you, that is what can happen to you. Let's have the next verse. There's six verses for those of you who are counting down the verses. We're doing well. We're at verse 3. He restores my soul. He restores my soul. What's your soul? What's your soul? Well, it's your mind, isn't it? It's your emotions. It's your will. It's up here in your head. And that's where the battle goes on for you. That's where the battle goes on. And for as Christians, that battle still goes on, doesn't it? We still get temptations. We still get things thrown at us. And we need restoration. We need to be able to go to Christ and talk to him and let him restore us. Sometimes we just need a factory reset on our mind, don't we? We just need to get rid of all that rubbish that's accumulated there. And he does that. Look what happened in the Bible with the story of the woman at the well. The woman, a Samaritan, was at the well and Jesus was there. And he spoke to her. And why was she there? She was there midday, hottest time of the day. No other people were there gathering water. Because she was an outcast. Because of her history, because of what she'd done, the number of marriages she'd had. She was living with a man she wasn't married to. She was a bit of a social outcast. And she meets Jesus. And he talks to her and talks about living water. And she believed him. She believed him. She listened and she believed. And he said, basically, drink of me. Drink of me. And what did that faith do to her? That outcast went into the town and started shouting in the streets and gathering everybody. Come, come, come. The Messiah, he's up at the well. She would never have done that outcast, if she hadn't drunk his living water. So as sheep, we need to go where the shepherd takes us to drink of the water that he gives us. And let me assure you that living water is the best water that we can drink. Okay. And the restoring the soul. You have a problem with sheep as a shepherd. And that problem is that they can become cast. Now, to be cast is that they find a nice hollow in the ground. They're at peace. Everything's hunky-dory. Everything's wonderful. And they lie down in that little hollow. And sometimes they just get too comfortable and their center of gravity shifts. Their legs come up in the air and they can't get down again. Their own center of gravity works against them. when they're too comfortable or when they have too much wool. They've grown their wool and there's too much. It hasn't been sheared, it hasn't been cut. Just like when we accumulate so much stuff. No wonder there's so many businesses of storage rooms for rental. No wonder. Because what do? We accumulate, we accumulate, we accumulate so much stuff. And a sheep with too much wool, if it lies down in a hollow, that wool can prevent it from getting up. And the other reason that sheep can't get up when they're cast is because they're too fat. They're too fat. They're too heavy to get out of that hole. Bit like us when we're puffed up with pride, isn't it? We're puffed up with pride. We've got a problem. But we're too proud to do what God says. We've made an awful mistake. We've really offended somebody. And we know we've got to put it right. But we're too proud and fat and puffed up with ourselves to go and humble ourselves and say, I am so sorry. I got it wrong. Forgive me. He leads us in the paths of righteousness. We're all creatures of habit, aren't we? Just like sheep. How many people come to church every Sunday and sit in the same seat? And how many of you, if someone else is sitting in that seat first, get a little bit... I took a decision a while ago, I would not have a seat in the church that I claimed was mine. Some weeks I sit over here, some weeks I sit back there, some weeks I'm at the back, some weeks I'm down here. Ooh, what a weight off my shoulder. I don't have to worry. I'm not offended if anybody sits in my seat. It's great. I have other different people around me every week. It's great. I'm worshipping alongside different people. It helps me. But sheep are creatures of habit and they want to go to the same pasture. They always want to go and graze in the same place. And if they're left to their own devices, they will. And they will ruin that pasture because they will overgraze it. They will reduce, they will actually chew at the roots of the grass. And it then won't grow again. Afterwards. So we need moving on. We need to move into new ground. When you come to Christ, have you noticed how the Lord moves you on? How God moves you on? I can remember I've been with a Christian a few years, and the Lord said to me, go to the castle and pray for a woman with a bad leg. I said, what? Am I hearing that? But it was so clear in my head. Go to the castle in Fuengirola. Go to the top and pray for a woman with a bad leg. And first of all, I thought, am I crazy? And secondly, I thought, how can I just go up to a woman and say, oh, I see you got a bad leg. I've come to pray for you. I didn't know what to do, but I thought, well, the shepherd's speaking to me, I better go. So I got on my motor scooter, went down to the castle, went up to the top, no one there. I thought, okay, you are crazy, Howard. But then, what happened? You know, there's a steep side to the castle, the steep side up. An older grandparents, Muslim couple arrived, walking normally. And I thought, it's not them. And then a guy arrived, younger guy. I thought, must be the son. He came up, he was walking normally, and he wasn't a woman. So I thought, I'm going to go. And then a little child arrived. And then a little child came running up. And then behind the little child came the mother. And the mother was walking like this. And she'd been walking like that since birth. So I thought, okay, woof, there is a woman with a bad leg. What are the odds? She was there. And then I thought, how am I going to go up to her and just say, it was obviously they were a Muslim family. Well, how am I going to walk up to this family and just say, hi, I'm a Christian, I want to pray for you. Well, you see, because I've gone there in obedience, the Lord opened the door. The younger man came to me and said to me, are you from Fuengirola? I said, well, I live here. And he started a conversation about where to go, things he could do. They were visiting for the day. So the Lord opened the door to me. And all I had to say to him was, is that your wife and your child? He said, yes. And he said, my wife has had that problem with her leg, with her hip, since birth. He opened the door. So all I had to say to him was, do you mind if I pray for her? He said, no problem. We'll pray. So I went over to her, and I realized, as I started to speak to her, she was a little bit of an outcast in that family. She was the daughter-in-law. She was a little bit of an outcast. She was left to look after this child. But can you imagine the effort going up to the castle, up that steep path, with a bad leg? She was exhausted. She was in pain. And she was looking after her child. Anyway, I said, can I pray for you? She said, well, yeah. I said, I'm going to pray to Jesus. She said, no problem. So I started praying and praying and praying. And what God did was he took me to new pastures. He was preparing me for the times I'm going to pray for people in this church. And I needed to get some practice in. I needed to break down some barriers. The barrier of praying for healing and expecting the person to be healed. You're all wondering what the end of the story is, aren't you? I'll tell you in a moment. Christ will move you on. If you come to the shepherd and you accept that you're not always going to stay in the same pastures with exactly the same routines, exactly the same role in the church, exactly the same everything, he will move you on and you will see amazing things happen. That lady, I prayed, I knew the Holy Spirit was saying, thank you, you've done your job, and I left. About 4 or 5 months later, I was in my morning time with the Lord, and he said, oh, Noor, that was her name, which I think means light in Arabic, Noor is healed. That she was healed. That gave me such encouragement. He did it again with me. I'm not going to go into other long stories. He sent me in an airport to pray for someone in front of everyone. Breaking down the barriers, getting me into new pastures. Walking me in the paths of righteousness. Teaching me to be the sheep that he wanted me to be. Okay, let's move on quickly. Can we have the next verse? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Okay, this verse is quoted so much. What shepherds did or do, and what David would have done with his sheep was in the spring and heading into summer, move the sheep up to the high ground where the best pasture would be. But to get to the high ground, you've got to go through the valleys. If you try and go up the side of a valley, it's too steep for the sheep to get up. So he would take them through the valleys. And of course, there would be shadows in the valleys. It would be dark at times. But also, there'd be predators prowling. They'd be followed by lions, bears, cougars, and all those kinds of animals. And they would be following them, often on the high ground. But a shepherd would get his sheep through it. He would be able to protect them. And our shepherd will take us through those dark valleys. I'll move on quickly now. We don't have to fear evil because we have that protection. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they come from me. Rod and staff. Shepherds have two main weapons, two main tools that they use. The staff is used for guiding the sheep. It's the one with the crook on the end. And they use it just to guide the sheep. And David would have used it when he was a shepherd for when a lamb was born, for lifting up the lamb and examining it, putting the lamb in the crook and lifting it up so that he could see it. He wouldn't handle it because the mother might reject the lamb because of the smell of the human being on it. So the crook would be used to lift it up and to examine it. Just like our shepherd examines us. Except he's a bit more hands-on. The rod is the main weapon. Shepherds would have their rod made of hard wood. It'd be bigger at one end and narrower at the other. And as young shepherds, they would practice not only using it as a weapon to fight, but throwing it. The rod was a throwing instrument as well as an instrument for combat with animals. And the rod is like scripture. It's like God's word. It protects us. And of course, Moses used his rod to do God's will. Let's have the last verse 5, please, there. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You know, when shepherds took their sheep or take their sheep up to the high ground, what's the high ground called? In Spain? Una mesita, no? A table. Table Mountain in South Africa, no? It's called the table. And the sheep would go up there, they'd graze on luscious, luscious grass, best of the year. But the predators would follow and the predators would be around them. And so the sheep would be eating on that table with enemies around. Now, who do we eat with? When you know Jesus, who are you going to sit down with to eat? With him. And that's the amazing thing, isn't it? That he wants a relationship with us and he wants to sit down at that table with us. He wants us there. In a chair. And him sitting there across the table. And to have that relationship. And to focus on him. And not worry about the things around us, the world around us, the enemies around us, the troubles we have around us. Because we can eat with him. And that's the amazing thing about faith, isn't it? Absolutely amazing thing that we have a personal relationship with Jesus. Okay, nearly finished. Verse 6, the last verse here. Sorry, can you go back? 5. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Sheep were anointed with oil. They had two things. They had nasal fly and they had scab. These two infections were deadly, could send them blind or could eventually kill them. And if the shepherd anointed their head with a mixture of oil, sulfur and herbs, they were completely protected. Completely protected, and they'd have no problem. Scab was contagious. It was when they rubbed their heads together. And the nasal fly was a fly that would fly up their nose. We as Christians are anointed. We have his protection over us. We have to be careful who we rub our heads together with. But the Lord protects us. The Lord protects us. He puts that anointing upon us. And my cup runs over. My cup runs over. Whose cup runs over? What did Jesus say in the Garden of Gethsemane before his crucifixion? Take this cup from me. But if it be your will, I will drink of it. I will take it. And because he did that, our cup overflows. We have the plenty because of his sacrifice. And that is at the heart of Christianity. Our cup overflows because he took the bitter cup and was crucified for us so that we can live in freedom. I'm going to bring it to a halt there. Let me just go back to the beginning. We all need a shepherd. If we don't choose Jesus as our shepherd, the world will put one over us. And that is very, very dangerous. You will be led into all the wrong places. You'll drink all the wrong water. You'll consume all the wrong food. And sooner or later, it will catch up with you. Can we stand, please? What I'd like to do is, I'd like us to speak out Psalm 23 together. Words have power. And when you speak out, you are speaking out with power when you speak scripture. So let's speak out Psalm 23. And let me tell you, as you say the words, the Lord is my shepherd, and as you say, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. As you say all those things, you are affirming faith in Christ. You are affirming your faith in Christ. If you have never affirmed faith in Christ before, by speaking out this psalm, you are doing it. You are saying, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Shall we all say it out together? Yeah. And let's bring Jesus into our hearts through these wonderful words. Okay? Speak it with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Amen.